tomorrow?
Oh, my God. Thank you for coming. I'm so glad to see you here. This is Sunday Assembly Madison. We are a secular congregation. We have a great motto: live better, help often, and wonder more. And our main point of purpose is to provide a place of community and fellowship for secular people who are otherwise, they used to use the word unchurched. But we're building a community here for the rest of us. And we're going to start out with a couple of songs as soon as our main singer gets back. So I need to tell a couple of jokes. Do you like?
Only if they're good.
We have Alo Black doing I Need a Dollar. Vesna is going to karaoke that. And then we've put together the Money Money song from Cabaret. This is far and away the most challenging thing we've ever done. We have voice now, guitar, and a great pianist here, Pete. And I think we put together something that you'll enjoy. How are we doing back there? I did my entire. That's not it's all yours.
Bad times coming.
Yeah. upon that your left eye will never love you more than you grow quite a lot. You can take it on the chin, call a cab, and begin to recover on the 14-carat yacht. Money makes the world go around the world, go around the world, go around. Money makes the world go around, and then we can be sure on being poor. Money, when you haven't any coal in the stove, and you freeze in the winter, and you burst to the wind and your face, when you haven't any shoes on your feet, and your coat's thin as paper, and you look 20 pounds on your waist, when you gotta get a word of advice from your back to the pastor, he will tell you to love evermore. But when hunger comes, you rap, rat-a-tat-tat-tat at the window.
At the window.
Who's there?
Hunger.
See how love lies at the door. For money makes the world go around the world, go around the world, go around. Money makes the world go around. Let me get some more. Money, 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 money. Give a little, get a little. Money, 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 more. Again, a buck or a pound. That stinky, clanky, pounding sound. It's all that makes the world go around.
In the marble-lined entry, the legend U.S. United States Depository is engraved in gold, along with the gold seal of Treasury Department. The elaborate building and its widely publicized strength serves as a symbol of the value of the U.S. currency, as much as it does for the actual protection of the gold warehouse in it. Unlike the mints, which made coins, and the Bureau of Engraving, which prints paper money, the guardians of Fort Knox entertain no visitors. Would-be tourists are not even admitted onto the military base, much less into the secured depository managed by the Treasury Department. The very name of Fort Knox has become a synonym for wealth and security. The Fort Knox Bullion Depository contains approximately 4,600 tons of pure gold. This cash, along with a handful of others, gives the United States a total of some 8,000 tons of gold, about one-fifth of all gold ever mined in the world. Because gold does not rot, rust, or deteriorate, the gold sitting in Fort Knox today may have been mined hundreds or even thousands of years ago. It could have been made into many objects and melted many times throughout the years. Some of it may date back to the ancient gold mines of Nubia in Africa and Lydia in Asia Minor. Almost assuredly, some of it came from the booty seized from the Aztecs of Mexico by Hernan Cortes and from the Incas of Peru by Francisco Pizarro. Some of the gold may once have been Byzantine coins or part of a headdress from the ancient empire of Ghana. Some was panned from the Yukon in the 19th century by Irish and Scottish prospectors. Some lifted from the deep mines of South Africa by Zulu and, I practice this, Xhosa tribesmen. The whole history of gold on Earth now rests. The whole history of gold on Earth now rests in these chambers. The Treasury melted down the gold coins and other objects to make gold bricks. Although officials kept a careful record of weight and purity, they did not record the dates or designs of the coins. The gold is stored in bars of 62.5 pounds each. The bars need no wrapping or other protection because they do not flake or deteriorate. Aside from small amounts taken out for sale to make commemorative coins for events such as the Olympics, the gold sits and waits. In truth, the gold in Fort Knox actually has nothing to do with the American dollar. The piles of gold are part of the wealth of the American government, as are government storehouses filled with soybeans, nickel, and old furniture. But they are not part of the money system. The dollar no more rests on the gold at Fort Knox than on the government stockpiles of processed cheese.
Executive Director of the Wisconsin Democracy Campaign's mission is to get money out of politics. He was editor and publisher of the Progressive magazine for most of his 32 years there. He's an author. He just has written a book called You Have No Rights, Stories of America in an Age of Repression, and was editor to Democracy in Print, the best of the progressive from 1909 to 2009. Mr. Rothschild has written numerous opinion pieces. His work has appeared in the Chicago Tribune, the LA Times, the Miami Herald, as well as many others. His appearances include Nightline, National Public Radio, C-SPAN, and actually the O'Reilly Factor, which he's described as being an act of masochism. Here in Madison, you can catch Matt on 92.1 The Mic, Madison's progressive talk radio station, and in the Week in Review show with Joy Carden on WPR, Wisconsin Public Radio. He lives in the town of Dunn with his wife, Jean. So please join me in welcoming Matt Rothschild.
Gathering, and I, as a longtime atheist, am happy to hear about it and happy to be with you. Today, it's also an honor to be in any church that's named after James Reed, who was a civil rights activist and is immortalized in the movie Selma, which by all rights ought to get an Oscar tonight. James Reed was killed by a mob in Selma when he went down there following the call of Martin Luther King to help out in the protests and the marches. He was killed by racists who were never convicted, even though there were plenty of witnesses. So I'm kind of the son of civil rights activists in a small way in the North Shore of Chicago. My mom and my dad were active in the fair housing movement there. And so this has a special resonance for me. I want to talk about where we are with campaign finance reform, or lack of that, how we got here, where we're going, and what we need to do to turn things around. Where we are is quite simple. We're going downhill. Campaigns are more expensive than they've ever been. The campaign in 2014 for federal offices in Congress were the most expensive ever. Almost $4 billion were spent on the midterm elections alone. Here in Wisconsin, spending by outside groups went up almost 80% in legislative races in the race for the Attorney General. And spending for the governor's race was up more than 100%, more than double what it was 4 years ago. Nationally, a smaller and smaller percentage of the 1% is giving a larger and larger amount. The average donation to outside groups nationally was $8,000 in this last election, which is up more than 400% since 2010. And now we have the Koch brothers pledging to give them and their billionaire buddies $889 million in the election to come in 2016. So that's a lot of money. It's a lot of money that you and I and the average citizen who makes $54,000 a year can barely contemplate. I mean, if you make $54,000 a year, you're not going to be giving $8,000 of that $54,000 in campaign contributions, are you? So it's a real problem. How did we get here? We got here in part from a series of Supreme Court cases that date all the way back, actually, to the 19th century. Supreme Court cases that stipulated that corporations were persons, which doesn't make any common sense, and doesn't make any moral sense, and doesn't really make any political sense either. But that's the underpinnings. And then the most recent Supreme Court decision that reaffirmed all that was the Citizens United case, most infamously in January 2010. We just passed the fifth anniversary of it. And this decision I'm going to go into in a little bit of detail because it's such a crazy decision. It's such a corrosive decision. It was a 5-4 decision by the majority, Justice Anthony Kennedy writing the majority opinion, Justice John Paul Stevens writing a fantastic minority dissent. My dad used to work with Justice John Paul Stevens in Chicago as a lawyer in the law firm Rothschild, Stevens, and Berry. So I knew Justice Stevens, he's still alive, when my dad was alive. And he was an incredible person, really. He's a Republican. He was put on the bench by Gerald Ford, But he became the most liberal person on the Supreme Court until Justice Bader Ginsburg. So this Citizens United case rests on five fallacies. I'm going to run them down real quick, but it's not that I'm a lawyer. My dad was a lawyer, my grandfather was a lawyer, my three older brothers were a lawyer. I escaped that fate, but I think like a lawyer sometimes, maybe. Anyway, five fallacies. Fallacy number one, corporate political speech, the majority said, should be as protected as individual political speech. Here's Justice Anthony Kennedy. Political speech of corporations or other associations cannot be treated differently under the First Amendment simply because such associations aren't natural persons. So this gets to the corporations or persons problem. And Justice John Paul Stevens debunked this. Here's what he said. In the context of election to public office, the distinction between corporate and human speakers is significant. Although they make enormous contributions to our society, this is the Republican in him talking, corporations aren't actually members of it. They can't vote or run for office. And because they may be managed and controlled by non-residents, their interest may be in conflict in fundamental respects with the interests of eligible voters. Our lawmakers, he said, have a compelling constitutional basis, if not also a democratic duty, to make measures designed to guard against the potentially deleterious effects of corporate spending in local and national races. And this is an interesting part of his dissent. He invoked our founders, which the conservative justices love to invoke the founders if they want to make a conservative ruling. Here, Stevens invokes the founders to make a liberal distinction and an important one. Unlike my colleagues on the majority side said, the founders had little trouble distinguishing corporations from human beings. And when the founders constitutionalized the right to free speech in the First Amendment, it was the free speech of individual Americans they had in mind. And then he said, Thomas Jefferson famously fretted that corporations would subvert the Republic. And then Stevens, in a footnote, provided a quotation from Jefferson. This is Jefferson talking in 1816. I hope we shall crush in its birth the aristocracy of our moneyed corporations. Well, obviously, we haven't crushed it. In its birth, the aristocracy of our moneyed corporations. Our moneyed corporations are in full adulthood now, and they're ruling the roost. So that was fallacy number one. Fallacy number two, political speech by corporations cannot be restricted. Here's Justice Kennedy again, writing for the majority. Political speech must prevail against laws that would suppress it, whether by design or inadvertence. And by that he means the political speech, not just of human beings, but of corporations and associations. And the sweeping nature of the statement, political speech must prevail, would suggest, and Justice Clarence Thomas echoes this suggestion, that there should be no restriction whatsoever on any amount that any individual can give to any person running for office. Because if money is speech, then you should, and political speech must prevail, then what's to say the government can tell you you can't go give Scott Walker a check for $100 million if you want. So they didn't quite go that far. They said if there's a quid pro quo, if you're bribing someone, can't do it. But the logic of the decision suggests that you can. The third and fourth fallacies, I'm going to real quick because they are the two most naive statements ever written in a Supreme Court majority decision. Fallacy number three, independent expenditures, including those made by corporations, do not give rise to corruption or the appearance of corruption. Fallacy number four, the appearance of influence or access, furthermore, will not cause the electorate to lose faith in our democracy. Those are direct quotes from the majority opinion in Citizens United. You want to ask yourself what planet these guys live on? Because it's just common sense. If you have the Koch brothers giving almost $1 billion to elect candidates that they like, you've got to believe those candidates, when they're in office, are going to dance to the tune of the Koch brothers. And that's just common knowledge. And anyone who heard the bogus phony phone call that Scott Walker got by the guy who was pretending to be a Cobra, you saw how an elected official dances to the tune of his big guns. And then the American public has already lost faith in our democracy, largely. I mean, 8% in poll after poll of the American people, 8% say corporations have way too much influence over not only the economy, but over our political system. So it's just a joke to say there isn't corruption or the appearance of corruption, or that either of those two things don't corrode our belief in our democracy. To bring it a little closer to home, we have Diane Hendricks of ABC Supply in Beloit, who gave the Republican Party in Wisconsin $1 million last fall. And she is famously portrayed in the documentary There Goes Janesville as hugging Scott Walker and whispering in his ear, "When you can make Wisconsin a right-to-work state." And Scott Walker responded right there on film, "We're going to do it, but first we're going to divide and conquer." Well, here we are. If you don't think that $1 million had anything to do with where we are, I think that's also naive. And it's a real, real problem for our democracy. So, fallacy number five, no sufficient governmental interest justifies limits on the political speech of nonprofit or for-profit corporations. Another blanket, sweeping statement, which is really hard to understand. I mean, isn't protecting democracy, isn't the integrity of our elections and our democracy itself sufficient governmental interest? The majority in Citizens United seem to think the rights of these artificial person trump everything else, including the health of our democracy. Here's Justice John Paul Stevens again rebutting. A democracy cannot function effectively when its constituent members believe laws are being bought and sold. Starting today, January 2010, corporations with large war chests to deploy on electioneering may find democratically elected bodies becoming much more attuned to their interests. Court's decision, he added, undermines the integrity of our democratic institutions and will undoubtedly cripple the ability of ordinary citizens, Congress, and the states to adopt even limited measures to protect against corporate domination. Well, that's where we are today. Corporate domination of our democracy. And the idea that we have one person, one vote, while formally true when we wander into the voting booth, is certainly not true in reality. Because your vote doesn't count as much as the Koch brothers' vote. And the Koch brothers give, and their billionaire buddies, almost $900 million. When they call or go to Washington and knock on an elected official's door whom they gave money to, you can bet that elected official is going to welcome them in and have them sit down and talk to them as long as they want. Whereas if you go knock on the door, you're not going to be let in. And that's just basic. That's just the way influence peddling works. And it's a tragedy what's happened to our democracy with this phony notion that corporations are persons. I mean, these Supreme Court decisions are eating our democracy. And as someone who respects Bernie Sanders a lot, I hear Bernie Sanders talking about how we're no longer a democracy, how we're a plutocracy. We're a government run by money. Or as someone who likes to listen to Elizabeth Warren talk, and she talks about the system being rigged. This is how the system gets rigged, right here. With the way money contaminates our political system. So, what do we do about it? Well, there are a few things we can do. One, we can hope and study the actuarial tables of the people on the Supreme Court and hope that the composition of the Supreme Court changes in a favorable way. I don't think that's the best approach. It certainly isn't a fundamental approach. We have a fundamental problem. Fundamental problems require fundamental solutions. The fundamental solution is to amend the U.S. Constitution and say that corporations aren't persons and money isn't speech, and we as citizens, through our elected officials, can say how elections can be regulated. I mean, that is a central element of grabbing our democracy back from the people and corporations who have stolen our democracy. So we must amend the Constitution of the United States. It's a long process. It's not going to happen tomorrow, but it can happen. And actually, in 16 or 17 states, people in those states have gone on record saying they want to amend the Constitution that way. Excuse me. In 54 villages, towns, cities, and counties right here in Wisconsin, the people have voted for their representatives by overwhelming margins to say that they want to amend, that we want to amend the Constitution and say that corporations aren't persons and money isn't speech. And this isn't just in liberal places like Madison. This is in, Douglas County to Delavan, Eau Claire County to the city of Waukesha. People have voted literally 60%, 65%, 70%, 75%, 80%, Democrats, Republicans, independents alike, to amend the Constitution. And there is a bill pending up at the Capitol about this that Lisa Subak introduced, as Chris Taylor introduced last year, to give the voters in Wisconsin a chance in 2016 to vote on a referendum. That would be advisory, but it would give us the chance to say yes or no. Do we want to amend the Constitution? Do we want to say corporations aren't persons? And money isn't speech. So that's one of the exciting things I see happening out there. And you can go to movetoamend.org. That's a great group that's been doing a lot of work on this. Also, Public Citizen has been doing that. You can go to citizen.org. People for the American Way has been working on this. There are a lot of good groups working on this. Actually, there are a lot of good groups here in Wisconsin, good pro-democracy nonprofit groups working on this issue and other democracy issues in a coalition called Our Democracy 2020. We're trying to get together. We're all working together, much more so than I ever thought when I was over at the Progressive, because I wasn't involved day-to-day with nonprofit pro-democracy groups. I was trying to edit that magazine. But lo and behold, it's not just a paper coalition. People are actually working from various groups together. We're meeting regularly, and we're doing real good work. So that's exciting, too. People aren't just in their own silos, worried about their own little job titles and their own little grant proposals. We're beyond that now. We need to be beyond that now. So there are other things that can happen, too. There's something happened in New York City where small donors, if you give up to $175, the city of New York will then match, not only match that, but match six times that. So your donation will be multiplied six times. Say you gave $100, and then you get $600 more toward that candidate that you gave $100 to. So that the small donor, the non-rich donor, can have some say. The limit of contributions to candidates, I don't know what it is in New York federally, I think it's $2,700. So if you gave $100, you're getting $600 versus the person giving $2,000, for instance. So it's not so lopsided as the $2,000 is to the $100. This, an ordinance quite similar to this, is on the ballot on Tuesday in Chicago. So this is a creative way to try to at least, not exactly level the playing field, but make the playing field less perpendicular, less tilted. So another solution is public financing. Full public financing, voluntary public financing, but you could do a system where if you got a certain number of signatures, say you got 1% of the signatures that leading party candidate got in the last election. So Walker versus Burke, well, there were about, 2.5 million votes. So if you got 25,000 signatures, you could get full public financing at the level of the last election that a major party candidate got. I mean, that's a lot of signatures. It's not an insurmountable number. That's one way we could go about it, and I think it's an important way to think about it. Another way is thinking about where all the money goes in these campaigns, why these super rich corporations and individuals are giving money, where those expenditures go. Well, they go to, you know where they go to. They go to buy commercials on TV. These awful gutter, I think Obama called them, dragging us into the gutter, these kinds of commercials. And the airwaves are public. We own the air. The media is borrowing those airwaves from us, the American people. And we can, as the government, and through our representatives, we should be able to say to ABC and CBS and NBC and all the networks, and all the cable stations for that matter, you're using our airwaves, you're using our property to bring your signals into people's homes. Guess what? During the election, you've got to give from 6 o'clock to 10 o'clock free airtime to all candidates who pass a certain threshold. That would be one way also to solve this problem. But we're not the only democracy ever to face this question of how to deal with corrupt money influence in politics. And we could look to other countries as well to see how they do that. And I got to study that. I haven't studied it yet, but it's something I want to do in this next week or two, and just take a look. What does England do? What does Canada do? What does France do? What does Sweden do? Not like those places are dictatorships. Someone solved this problem ahead of us. There's no reason we need to fall behind. So we got to do something. That's the basic point. Our democracy is decaying and collapsing right here before our eyes. And I'm reminded, I have the sign on my wall at work. I've got a picture of Fighting Bob LaFave and Bel Case LaFave. In between that picture is this famous quote by Fighting Bob LaFave that says, "The cure for the ills of democracy is more democracy." And that's what we need. We need more democracy now. We need it now in the United States. We really need it now right here in Wisconsin. Thank you.
Very interesting. Yes, I, it's my fault. It's my fault. I didn't start out the program by announcing that we're going to have a new segment, and it's called Airing and Sharing. And we've gotten some feedback from you that you'd like to have more of an opportunity to comment, to tell stories, to share a grief, share a joy, something that's happened to you during the week, and above all, to comment on something that you may have heard today here at our assembly. Whether you want to complain, or exaggerate, or exasperate, or extrapolate, or just tell a shaggy dog story. And we're going to devote 7 or so minutes to this segment, and people will line up on this side, and they'll get the microphone, be able to talk for about 2 minutes apiece, if anybody has anything that they'd like to say. My apologies for not announcing this ahead of time. Does anybody want to come up and talk about the weather? That's a good topic. Tomorrow's going into the freezer.
Morning.
Could you introduce yourself?
Yes, my name is Richard Arthur Whitmore. Second left off the Arthur here. Just want to remind you that no time in the history of humanity has fiat money ever succeeded. So think about it. That paper you're carrying around in your pocket, someday it's just going to be worth a piece of paper.
Thank you.
Hey. Attention. Is this actually working?
It is.
I tend to get wordy, so I should have written this down in a concise manner, but I will try to keep it short. I had a discussion with our very hardworking president, Naomi, a couple of sessions back after Henry Steinberger had spoken about the fact that I disagreed with her comments following Henry Steinberger's discussion about smart recovery. And part of this was my own fault. I had not read the charter of Sunday Assembly, nor had I read the introductory material called About Sunday Assembly. In reading that, I think Sunday Assembly may not be a place for me. It seems that it's a little too wishy-washy, a little bit too much like a universalist Unitarian church. And I wonder, and I recommend that the Sunday Assembly here actually make sure every week they mention, or somehow in the email mention to people, that they should indeed read the charter and what Sunday Assembly is about. When I came to Sunday Assembly the first time, I had it. I found out about it from somebody who told me there was an atheist grouping getting together that was dealing with atheist issues. I am a devout atheist. And I found some of the comments that Pippa and Sanderson had made to be incredibly contradictory. If you look at the charter and you read the full charter and you read the About Sunday Assembly, you will see on the one hand that they're talking about creating godless congregations all across the world, and in the next moment they're talking about allowing everybody a voice, as long as it's a voice that celebrates life. Well, they say they're completely inclusive. So you could very easily have religious people show up who say that their way of celebrating life is through Christ, through Allah, or through anything else, and that would be a positive voice. Whereas on the flip side, they mention in either the charter or About Sunday Assembly the fact that they do not want people getting up there making diatribes about why atheism excludes other groups. For example, finds negative qualities in various religions and the things that religions do. And I don't think an organization can be both a godless congregation and one that's totally inclusive of God, of people who believe in God. I think it's a contradiction in terms. And so I would like to find out if there are other people who have not read the charter and About Sunday Assembly, please read it. And then I think we need to have a discussion here about if indeed we want to follow the strictures of what Evan, Pippa, and Sanderson talked about, or if we want to indeed create a true godless congregation, as opposed to one that's sort of wishy-washy. and I think is already covered by the Universalist Unitarians. I think their congregation welcomes everybody. And if we're just going to welcome everybody too and say that all opinions are okay, I'm okay, you're okay, I don't see how we're any different from you. And then I'm not sure what the purpose of Sunday Assembly is at all at that point. So thank you.
The difference is that they actively accept and will promote a form of religion.
So does
where's not
here? Yes.
The assembly don't touch the subject.
No, that's not true. If you read the charter and if you read I have it with me. If you want me to look it up, I will read it. I've read it too, and it specifically says we are all inclusive, and it says we don't believe in God, but if you do, we will not tell you you're wrong. So if you're at that point, if you're not able to say at a Sunday assembly gathering, I think there is something wrong with religion. I think it is a negative force in the world. Then what's the difference? And they're saying that you should not be making those negative comments. So at that point, I don't see how it's any different from you. And again, I have to quote, well, I mean, I have to pass the underline if you want to read them. I'm sorry?
I think there are other outlets for that.
Well, I guess I'm asking, I'll ask you if this is the same as you, what have you mean? Okay. We can talk about it after. I don't think there are other outlets for it. I thought this was the outlet for that.
And with that, it's time to do our meet the neighbors. Do we have another person? One more?
One.
Very short. One more. Thank you. And you are, sir?
I'm John Cooper. Probably see a little too mad up here. If anybody wants to know some thorough indoctrination on what we need to get from corporations are not people. There's a little book that's entitled Corporations Are Not People. It's written by Jeffrey Clements. And it's probably available on somewhere on the web on our book signing that we did. I think it's in Austria and Vermont. It gives a detailed explanation of how we got from there to where we are here. And I put it on my cell phone. Take it on my cell phone and play it and get more and more enthused. There's another debate by David Cobb, who is the head of Move to Amend, and a man by the name of Bach, a lawyer by the name of Bach, who presents the corporate side of Citizens United to the Supreme Court. It's about 15 minutes. The whole debate is in half an hour, and David Cobb is about a 15-minute talk. And if anything will get you going on that, those two things will do it for our suggestion. You can play it and get more and more radical.
If that's possible.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, well, now it's time for about 5 minutes or so break. Stand up and meet your neighbors. Continue the discussion that we've been having. One thing you might talk about is what you're going to do when the weather finally warms up and we can get out and quit being so restricted to the house again. I'm going to start taking my long, long walks again. So we'll be back.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Jesus' name. We know when we understand, all I've begun is deep in your hand. The mass of truth was among the guys, but you can't fool all the people all of the time. So now we see the light.
We were number one at halftime. Number one at halftime, and then but we were doing pretty well, and we're instituting a new activity, a book club, and this will be something that you will help organize. Please contact us through email if you're interested in being in the book club. The topic that we're going to try to do first is a book by Dale McGowan called Parenting Beyond Belief. So if you have little ones in the house, you can get the book and come and talk about it. And I'll... Will you be leading it?
Yes. Yeah.
You know,
I want to read the book. I just want to know if other people want to read it with me.
And that could be a great topic for some of you, for the rest of us like me, or empty nesters and children are out of the house. We could read the complete collected works of Marcus Aurelius or something like that. Make suggestions about what you'd like to come and attend for the book club segment, because certainly there's enough room if we can have more than one of those. And that's about it for the announcement segment.
Donations.
We have our donation bank box in the back. You can slip some bucks in, we hope. And there is our donation button on the website, functional. It's functionally working.
It's under fundraising now, What does it say instead of donate?
The donate button works.
Yeah. So you'll find it.
Yeah, we're 501c3. Everything's tax deductible. And now we've reached the point for thoughts, for reflections. This segment does not always have to be the MC. Up until now, it has been. If you know in advance that we're covering a topic that you know something about or has some strong opinions about, you can prepare a presentation about it, please let us know and we can include you in the box section. Now, it's my turn.
Uh-oh. And I'm going to put the microphone down. Hopefully you can all hear me. I'm a bit of a loud mouth. And talk about our topic today. Boy, divide and conquer, that really strikes me. American democracy is in some trouble. We're in a real mess, and something has to be done. Well, I'm going to do something about it, and I'm going to do something about it right now, because I'm a guy with connections, and I'm a mover and a doer. And I've used my connections to contact a very influential and powerful guy. And all he has to do is call me on the phone. You know, these people, they have busy schedules. So we'll just wait around for a second. Do you have a joke, sir?
I do.
You do? What is your joke? Well, we don't have to do that. I got the call. So, as you can see. Hello? Hello, sir. Oh, thank you. Thank you for agreeing to this interview, Batman. It's so fine. Wait, I'm sorry. I'm sorry, Mr. Wayne. I know this association between you and the Bat is just a bunch of urban legends that you're not connected in any way. You're not connected at all. But please don't hang up. Thank you, sir. Thank you. Oh, I'm a reporter with the Daily Planet, sir, here in town. You may have heard of it. Yes. That's the paper. Yes, the paper. Clark? Yes, I know Clark. We work on the same floor. My cubicle's a little bit down the aisle from his. No, we don't talk very much. Sometimes we meet at the coffee machine. He's a little stiff. A little stiff, a little formal, seems to be kind of a square, very shy around women. It's almost as though the man has a secret. You know? I don't think he really needs those glasses. Oh, okay, down to business, Mr. Wayne. I've called you because American democracy is in trouble. On top of the usual problems we have with lobbyists, Citizens United has allowed
unlimited black money to pour into the system, and it's very corrosive and corrupting. Democracy has been warped and twisted and distorted. We almost live in a plutocracy now. And I was wondering, I arranged this phone interview so that you could tell us what you're going to do about it. What do you mean you never followed me, sir? You're an A-list billionaire. Like, you could use your money to improve the system, get rid of some corruption. You're at the tippy top of the 1% of the 1%. You could help set things right. You never thought of that. Well, what can you do? Well, you could ask some of your friends for advice. Charles and David, for example. Do you know them? No, not the boxed fruit delivery people. The other guys. Yes, those guys. You would like to help them do some good. Well, that's very noble. Where would you like to start, sir? Gerrymandering? Gerrymandering, that's a good idea. Congressional districts are mostly totally safe for whoever's elected. If you help elect some people to their districts, you may never have to help them get elected again. They'll just ride on in. I know that districts now look like a spider fighting an octopus, but that's what gerrymandering is all about. You could even buy a little shadow party inside the party of your choice, and then you could hold the collar and wag that dog. But wait a minute. If you got rid of gerrymandering, then you wouldn't be able to do that anymore, and you couldn't do that much good. So is that out? That's out. Okay, gerrymandering is out. Well, what else? What else would you like to affect? Super PACs? Great! Getting rid of super PACs would be wonderful. Just thinking out loud again, though, if you had your own and you got all your buddies to chip in, just think of how much good you could do yourself. So, do you still want to get rid of super PACs? No? Well, okay. What other ideas do you have? Raise the inheritance tax, well, that might be good. Make all Social Security, make all income taxable by Social Security, get rid of that limit, that cap. Reinstitute the gap, Glass-Steagall Act, that's possible. Regulate derivatives, Wall Street and hedge funds. There's an idea. Impose a 0.3% tax on all bond and stock trades to eliminate speculation by sub-second program traders and restore sanity to the markets. That's something. But wait a minute. I'm thinking just out loud again. You benefit from all these things in Wayne Industries, don't you? You do. So if you put all that into place, well, you'd still be rich. You'd still be very rich. But you wouldn't be as rich. And you wouldn't be able to do as much good. You know, I never thought of that. And go talk to Charles and David, see what they have to say. Well, okay. I'll wait on this article. But it's been so nice to speak with you. Excuse me? Oh, sure thing. Sure. I'll tell him that you called. I'll say hello to him for you when I get back to the office. Thank you for calling. Oh my gosh. I think I just corrupted Batman. thank you so much. We're going to close out with our last song from the Beatles. I hope everybody knows that. It's Can't Buy Me Love.
Well, while we are waiting for our pin, I'd just like to say that we are looking for more people to, you know, doesn't it look like fun to be leading some conference here on stage? We're looking for more people to come up and do this and take part in the fun. Also, we are looking for volunteers to get involved in other ways. Such as by being a minutes taker. We're looking for somebody to help with one of our, or to start to take on one of our missions, which is help often. And we are interested in doing more charitable works. And so we are looking for somebody to coordinate. It's the challenge. Peter, come on up. We're about to do Can't Buy Me Love. The challenge with charities is, for one challenge, is to find ones that are completely secular, and so we're looking for somebody who can coordinate good efforts in efforts that don't have religious strings attached. So if you're interested in any of those things, just send an email to the address on the brochure. Or if you're interested in getting involved in any way, we even have some open spots on board of directors. So, this next song here, Can't Buy Me Love, by Lennon McCartney. Hope you will enjoy. Okay. And again, for this one, high energy song, so I invite you to stand up if you're willing and able to.
Remember the scream.
Yes, the Paul McCartney.
Who can scream like Paul McCartney?
Yes. Who can scream like Paul McCartney? That's right. Alright.
There's a key stuck on here, so these are your opening notes, everybody.
Can't buy me. Okay, before we get started, let's hear you sing Can't Buy Me Love. Can't buy me love. What? Can you hear you?
Yeah.
Can't buy me love. One more time. Can't buy me love.
Money, money, can't buy me.
I can't go away.
Rise again.
So you're sneaking. Much later, and then I'll like 20 minutes after you sent it. Yeah.